G'day, I'm Bruce Mutard, and what you're about to be introduced to is my master's thesis, which I have been working on for the last 5.5 years, and it's a forensic study into the medium of comics, which, as I'll state from the outset, is not literature. It's not a genre of literature. Comics is a medium unto itself. Comics are comics. Should not be confused with any other medium, because it's not. Now, my principal purpose in coming into Monash University here to do a master's degree was to try and understand the process or what makes comics work. Now, as a practitioner for 25 years, but certainly for 20 years before coming here, I had a great intuitive understanding of comics as opposed to any kind of deep knowledge of the medium. I had learnt just of my own accord. There's no school or tertiary course or even a short course much in working with comics, and that's just by and large, around the world, that's still the case. There are a couple of schools in the US and in Europe now that have sprouted up that where you can study comics at a tertiary level, but it's a medium that's never been taken terribly serious enough for that to occur up until just quite recently. Anyway, so I learnt just by doing, just by making them and making every mistake there was in the book, and studying the medium by studying the past masters, which is in art history itself pretty much the way it was always done. You learn by doing. Anyhow, what I had noticed as in my practice was that there was a really substantial qualitative difference in telling a story with words only and telling a story with pictures. And what I mean by that is that I used to write my scripts in some detail, quite extensively, not in the sense that I put everything in panels or wrote panel one, this happening and this is the dialogue. I would just write mostly dialogue with a few scenic descriptions here and there, change of scene and so forth, knowing that after I finish writing the script and I'm satisfied that it's coherent, all the characters are set and all of this sort of thing, I would adapt it to images. And I always use the term adaptation very advisedly. It's not a breakdown, which I think sounds very negative, because that implies to me that the script is imperfect, that unless I break it down and compose it into images, it's incomplete. Well, that's not true. Adaptation is from one medium to another. And that's what's happening. A linear script, all words only, into images, quite a different medium. And what that means, I was very curious, because I always found that my script, the story I wrote in the script, would change substantially when I adapting it to images. Because thinking visually in imagistic form just gave me a whole lot of new ideas about what to do. It's not as if I never thought of images when I was writing the script. Things would pop into my head, but primarily they wouldn't. Because I left it to the stage of doing the layouts and the adaptation. And because of that substantial transformation, the way panels are organised and the way I set characters within the panel, mise-en-panel, to sort of paraphrase mise-en-scene in cinema, the setting of the scene in each frame, and in the way those settings on each frame were juxtaposed to one another on the page. I wondered if there was something universal, some kind of principle at work in this. And henceforth, I was wanting to do a project where I could find out if there was something there. And coming into an institution like Monash or any art department where you could do this, what they give you is a secure base, access to a whole range of resources, other input from your supervisors or more than likely, in the case of comics, not to be from the comics area, but to be painters, sculptors, digital artists, photographers, and then, of course, meeting other students who are working on all these disciplines. And they give you all this input from external disciplines, because when you're a practitioner in your own discipline for so long, it is hermetic. You tend to self-reference to within the medium all the time. And it is very good to get out of that. And if you want to really understand a medium, you really do need to step outside of it for a while and then be able to look back at it. And so what a postgraduate degree gives you that opportunity, and that's actually really what you're doing. I mean, at a postgraduate level, it's called, it's a thesis by research. And research is about uncovering knowledge, about making new knowledge even. And that attracted me. So I came here, and my original intention was to just do another graphic novel and document these transitional changes. But instead, very quickly, within the first 7 or 8 months, I began to realise I needed to step outside of that and do something different. And my supervisor, the one who I adopted, Dr. Michael Vale, was talking about it, because he was a painter and an installation artist, video, and asking me the very provocative, interesting questions about the medium, and this could work in an exhibition, this could do this, and it started instilling the seeds in my mind that maybe I could do this. And then I started to imagine it in that way, and it was very exciting to me to think of doing comics outside of the square of the book, because I think when it's in a book, the encounter with the book is primarily always intimate. You're sitting there with it, and it's small, it's in your hands, and you flip the pages, and each page is a private encounter between you and the work, and that's wonderful, that's what books are. But in the gallery scenario, as we've got here, it's the opposite. It's big, it's open, it's public, it's fixed to the wall. You, the viewer, have to move against the work. You have to move in with respect to it. And not only that, instead of small panels so big on a page, large panels, far bigger than you. The way the page is set up, you can imagine this here being a page. In a book, of course, this would be so big. But here, this is bigger than I am. This page, if you like. I mean, I don't necessarily think of it as a page, it's really just a cluster, a section of storytelling. But it's quite qualitatively different. And that I was kind of fascinated. One of the major instigators of this idea was a trip to Italy I made as part of the course. It wasn't a compulsory part, but Monash has a small campus in Prato, which is just north of Florence in Italy. And we were there for 6 weeks, and it was sort of an art tour. And we went there, and I started seeing these narrative fresco cycles within the cathedrals and churches there, and these were chapels. You know, these are basically lives of saints for whom whichever church, whichever saint or holy figure that the chapel is dedicated to, or even the cathedral. And essentially I realised these were comics, because they were large juxtaposed images telling a narrative in sequence, which in these sites can have quite interesting sequences across the chapel. I won't get into that here, you have to see it. But I realised that these were comics. It's the same medium. And that's when the penny dropped, that I was talking about a medium rather than a genre of literature. That comics, you know, they're in stained glass windows, cycles of storytelling with images next to one another. So one of the key insights I picked up while studying here in my research is that comics, for me, to define them, is juxtaposed narrative images. And by that, I mean, it's often called sequential art. It's often called, graphic stories, graphic novels, comics, and a whole range of other things. And that's all putting it somewhat towards its literary spectrum. But juxtaposed narrative images is basically simply the presence of an image that conveys a narrative. And a narrative means that there's a sense of occurrence there, that something is happening, that there's a before, a present, and an after. You get a sense that you're just looking at it and you can fill in what has happened by understanding or relating to the character or image, where it is and what is going on. But the key thing is that these images are placed next to one another on a surface. And that surface can be any surface, hence the wall, hence the book, hence a poster, hence the screen, or anywhere, literally, where images can be placed and set. Now, that was a key insight to me, and that juxtaposition is what defines comics for me, is that in a lot of other mediums, images are in place of one another, they're separate from one another, or sequential art. I mean, a PowerPoint presentation is sequential art. You've got one image after another in sequence, but they occupy the same space. In cinema, in animation, the images are presented in the same spot. Here, in comics, images cannot be presented in the same space. They must have their own space. And that's a very, very signal difference. And it's reading these images through in their separate space, but together, one after another, normally left to right, top to bottom reading, but not necessarily, then that composes a narrative in our minds. Now, what's the key thing? How does this happen? Well, it's you, the reader, developing a relationship with the said characters. And this is the other insight I discovered in my thesis, is that, as often said in literary courses, studies and how to write volumes that, or understanding how people relate to characters in a story, is that you identify with characters, you identify with the hero and you join them on the story. And I don't think that. I think you develop a relationship with them, and you develop a relationship with them in the same way you do with people in real life. And what I mean by that is a story develops a narrative, a life, if you like. There's lives being developed here. And I know as a writer, you know, all my characters have vast backgrounds and things that I've created in order to cite them and understand the personality that they have and why they are motivated to make the decisions that they do and so on. And to me, that's a relationship. So when you're talking about or to someone, or someone new, or someone even you know well, you have a relationship with them. You built up in your mind over time a body of knowledge about that person, about what they're doing. You have your own opinions about what they're doing, and if you speak to someone else about this friend or other person, you know, in the third person, oh, so-and-so, you know, they really just don't see or get that they are doing something wrong that's causing them a lot of problems, but I can't tell them that because they won't, you know, they don't like that, or, you know, and it's that, you know, that's the sort of way you talk about it. But I also noticed that you think about it in television shows or in books, and just say it's Game of Thrones or Breaking Bad or something like that, and around at work the next day, oh, did you watch the latest episode? And so didn't Walt, you know, go overboard with that, his reaction to Skyler there, and it was just crazy, you know, the guy, you know, just doesn't get his problems. And like, and this, when you talk like that, you're talking as if you're talking about real people. And that relationship I'm talking about, is you use the same words, and that sort of, to me, is the magic of storytelling. Creating these worlds and characters, and then you relate to them as you do in real life, and that also is, by proxy, a way of working out problems, a way of reflecting on yourself. You do relate because what's happening with these people in the story, for the most part, even if it's an action-oriented thing, is that you get it, you understand what they're doing, because the emotional core of the characters, by and large, is the same as everyone. You know, we all have the same emotional drives, appetites, core within us. And there are people who are, by and large, pretty good, but then there are people who are not very nice and they're nasty and all of that. And you relate in that way. So that, I think, is the pulling power of art and storytelling. And in comics, it's just the same thing in operation, but you have pictures, you look at them. And so, for instance, just say in this sequence, you've got a boy playing a video game, and his grandfather, who's been asked by his daughter and his mother to talk about this boy's quietness, his problems, where his mother is worried. And he's hoping that maybe he'll talk to his grandfather, who's a war veteran he had a lot of respect for. Now, when you're doing representational drawing like this, and I think comics requires fairly representational drawing, you know, you, figures that you can see straight away has the anthropomorphic quality, a human quality. And sometimes, I mean, that can be anything, really. If there's a speech bubble above it or a thought bubble above a toaster, you're thinking it's got an anthropomorphic quality. It's not a toaster anymore, it's a character. It's something that's thinking and it's alive, because as human beings, we relate to those things that talk to us. A series of images of a toaster sitting on a bench doing what a toaster does all day is not going to be all that engaging. One panel of it's fine, but a whole graphic novel of it is probably not going to be terribly entertaining. And however, if that toaster was thinking all day about its life as a toaster, then that would be a little bit more interesting, because the human element's been put in there, it's been projected into it. So, and this operates whatever the image is. So comics and any storytelling operates on this same principle. But what comics has, and I love, is access to two languages that we use every day that don't have words. One is facial expressions, and the other is body language. Now, we use those every day. We're constantly interacting with other people, and instinctively, biologically, hardwired even, we are constantly interpreting these expressions at a subtextual level in addition to the communication that we are having with the person, or not even that, if you're just looking at somebody sitting opposite you on a tram or in a restaurant or anywhere where other people are, you're constantly reading these signals. And in comics, if you're doing drawings similar to what I'm doing, you can utilise that. So that's why, in many respects, I have these silent panels where nothing happens, or I'm always conscious of the body language of the characters, because they speak volumes. And that's very, very important to me. Now, if we just move along here, I can give you an example. Take, for instance, here. This panel is constructed so that it looks like a teenage boy's bedroom. All the signs are there, pictures of bikini girls, movies, the computer, single bed. I mean, when I'm thinking about making an image, and I'm always putting in background quite detailed, I want the message to come across straight away that this is a teenage boy's bedroom, because it has all the signs of it. And a typical Western middle-class house where there's plenty of stuff. And I don't need to write about it. I mean, I wrote it in the script, teenage boy's bedroom, Michael's bedroom, but I've left it to the image to do the bulk of the storytelling. And that's what the magic of comics is for me, is that it has that capacity to say a lot without words. It's not so much, it's not a literal translation of a picture that tells 1,000 words. No, it's not, even though they do, it's not the case of that. But say you've got this panel here, Michael's mother is just cleaning up as she's doing, because you can see that here with the Windex and sponge and lifting up paper and so forth, and then she stops. She's noticed something, okay? And that's the body language we're talking about. A sudden, I've isolated this moment, and it's just left without a power border. It's just this frozen moment. But in this space, and this is one of the wonders of coming into the gallery, is I can show this, and then she's looking down. But if you guide her down, you'll be able to see down here what she's looking at. And it's a chest of drawers, and in it, it is open at the bottom drawer, and you can see a couple of girly mags, Soldier of Fortune, and a box. Now, of course, we come to the next panel, you see that she's reached down and it's coming up. Now, see in the gallery, I put this panel down here because you're looking down on it as she is. In a book, I can't do that, but in a gallery space, I can do this. And coming back up, she's reaching down for it, and each panel is reinforcing the idea that it's a kid's bedroom. The books on the shelves, the computers, but the books indicate that also that he's a literary type, he likes to read, so that's encouraging. Lots of boxes, which if I had more time, and I would have put names of video games and things on it, but nonetheless, there's as much information as needed. And then she stands, and you can see here the magazines, and looking at the box, she's looking through there, and of course, she's not particularly happy at seeing Soldier of Fortune in there, and again, it's just the expression on her face. That's all that's needed. I could have written that in the script and it would have been just a line literally describing all this, but there's multiple panels. And this is what I'm saying about the transition between word and image. One or two lines in script is being transformed into quite a sequence. I didn't write the expressions. I was saying, I'm drawing them. I'm telling them here with the expression itself. There's enough information there to get that idea. And of course, if we go over here, there's a shock reaction, classic shock reaction. And again, if you're writing in literary form, you would dispel all that out. But here, we as human beings have seen this expression numerous times. We've given it ourselves, we've seen it endlessly in movies and films and TV. We know what that means. And it's not necessarily that it always means that, but it's fairly unambiguous, but an image always had a degree of ambiguity about it. The thing about reading body language and facial expressions is that it is ambiguous. You encounter it would think you know what it means. You think what you're imagining what the other person is feeling or thinking, but you don't really know for sure. What they're saying could be quite contrary. And you look at it and go, are you okay? And you think, all right, you go, oh yeah, I'm fine. And you sort of think, no, you're not. But you clearly don't want to talk about it, and those sorts of interactions. So there is a term for it, it's called polysemous. Images are polysemous, multiple meanings. That is, they're not fixed. And in comics, it's argued, and Roland Barthes, the great French theoretician who created this term, argued that words fix images. And he was talking about cartoons and comics. He was quite, as a Frenchman, he was well aware of them and reading them at the time when he was one of France's leading intellectual lights, such as France. He argued that words fixed, and I still would not agree with that because words themselves are ambiguous too. They don't necessarily say what they mean, and many words have multiple meanings, and sometimes as a writer you would do that deliberately. So anyway, we have this reaction, and then this is one of the lovely things about a gallery. If we look at this here, the gun, in that box with the gun. And now in a comic, in a book, I would have drawn that. I would have drawn this gun, just a panel showing a gun. But when drawing this work, and I was originally going to draw it, I realized I could actually have the object rather than drawing it, because I'm in space now, I'm in a gallery. There's no reason why I can't have the actual object in place of the drawing. And of course, excited by that, I said, yes, I'm going to do it this way. Why not? And because it's quite commonplace for a gallery show to have be full of objects, to be an installation of objects, of physicality in the room, not just pictures on the wall anymore, but stuff in the room. And the gun, I think, I hope, has far more impact by its physical presence. The object is a visible reminder of its power, of its destructive power, and I think carries more weight than just another drawing. And I was very, very excited by that. And once I decided to bring objects in, it quite transformed the work that I was going to make, because I started seeing many other places where I could bring in objects as opposed to the drawings. And I took some panels out of the work where I had actually drawn them by that stage, and I've replaced them with objects. And this is something where, in understanding comics, these sorts of transformations of the medium from its confined form of 2D images on the page into space, into scale, into three dimensions gives us, I think and I hope, a better understanding of how the medium works. See, one thing is that in film, for instance, over the past 50 years, there's been a number of filmmakers and visual artists who've worked with the medium of cinema by bringing it into the gallery, and they've brought in projectors and they've deconstructed cinema in gallery space, in an art space, to better understand what was really going on, rather than just accept the fact that you go to a cinema, and we're talking about the days when cinema was still cinema, you went to the theatre. Rather than just accepting the fact of presentation, you know, that images were projected, what does it mean to project images? What does it mean to edit sequences together, to have diegetic music or non-diegetic music, and literally expose the mechanisms of cinema making, of storytelling, of that movie magic making? And a lot of art mediums have had that sort of examination. I mean, in film, it was a deconstruction process before then. After that had sort of run its course, they started dealing with narrative again, reassembling narrative, what it means to make narrative out of moving pictures. Comics has never been subjected to such scrutiny. And so for me, bringing comics into the gallery space, and comics have been exhibited numerous times, but usually just original art pages in frames on walls, I wanted to say, no, let's blow it up, let's expose it, let's pull it apart. And I think comics needs that scrutiny in this kind of area so that we better understand what's going on, because, as I said to you earlier, the level of research inside the formal aspects of the medium is still extremely slight. It's still dependent on Scott McCloud's understanding comics, which is a polemic rather than necessarily a really deep one. I mean, it's certainly a great starting point, but what's disappointed me in all my readings and research here is that most theoreticians who are writing about comics, you know, they're sociologists and literary theorists and studies professors who are writing about comics, if they're trying to talk about the formal aspects of the medium, they always refer to understanding comics as if this is carved in stone and brought down by a comic Moses called Scott McCloud. And in most other academic disciplines and fields, there's a constant upgrading of knowledge, of starting with something and theories bouncing back and forth. It's a bit like that Hegelian dialectic where there's thesis, antithesis, synthesis, and so on, and it keeps revolving in cycles. And this has not occurred in comics, and it needs to. Because as I just found with my own work, I, as a practitioner, McLeod's understanding of comics and Thierry de Grunstein's structuralist approach in France didn't resonate with me at all from what I knew as a practitioner. And I knew I had to go and discover what it was that was working for me and how it worked for me. So that was my research. And so I've been giving you an idea of all of that here. Now, if we just move along, you can see where, again, I've introduced new objects. I was originally going to draw these military medals, and then I thought, along with the other objects, I could actually get the military medals, which I bought online at a site which gives you, these are the real deal, mind you, and you order the level of medals. These are assembled in such a way that properly in the order and racked in exactly the way that you officially award them. There's this ton of rules about military medals and how they can be worn by soldiers and family of soldiers, and otherwise it's not a light thing. And in that respect, bringing the medals in here in that way, in the official way, brings all the input. Because one thing I haven't really discussed so far about this project is the content. Giving you a bit about my theory, but not the content. So I'll give you a bit of a background to that. This work, the subject matter, is essentially built around the Anzac myth. The characters are all derived from the trilogy of novels that I have been writing, starting with The Sacrifice, the Robert Wells trilogy. And one of the reasons I chose to use this subject, when I first came to do this project, it was not going to be that at all. It was, as I said a bit earlier, I've developed and created all these characters and lives already. And with that, I knew them so well that it was subject matter ready to hand, because the real thesis of this project is those formal aspects I was talking about. But I can't tell a comic, can't make a comic without content. It needs a narrative, it needs characters, it needs something to drive it along and to exist within inside the frame or outside the frame, whatever. So the story is really the making of an Anzac. It's the story of Michael Wells, who is Robert Wells, the principal character of The Sacrifice. It's his grandson, and it's set in contemporary time, whereas Robert Wells was, The Sacrifice was primarily set in the early years of World War II, and my original conception of the trilogy was that the fight, the second volume, would be his military service in the Second World War, which was New Guinea, particularly the battlefields of San Ananda, Gona and Buna. Dreadful, dreadful, dreadful battle, probably the worst battlefield any Australian soldiers served in the Second World War by a long way, and the casualty rates were 95%. Almost every single man who went into those battlefields did not come out walking, dead, wounded or sick. That's quite shocking. And the Japanese casualty rates were almost 100% all dead. I mean, we're talking thousands and thousands and thousands of men. And it's not known about. That's the thing. We all hear about Kokoda, we hear about Gallipoli. No one hears about these battles where thousands of men died in the worst conditions imaginable. I wanted to deliberately do that just to draw attention to the fact that this existed, because I just couldn't believe that it was so obscure. Anyway, but that was that. And then the return, the third volume, would be Robert's return to civilian life. How do you come back after having seen and done the worst? I mean, you're supposed to be discharged and just go back to being a civilian again. And you can't really do that. It's not that easy. Anyhow, there's a long story to it, but the second volume is the fight is not Robert Wells' military service, but it's actually focused on his daughter, Andrea, who is an army nurse in Vietnam. And Andrea is in the image. She's there, she's part of this work. You've seen the woman, that's Andrea. And Michael is her son, who in this work is really about his ultimate decision to enlist, which he ends up serving in Afghanistan and Iraq in the more recent conflicts. And in many respects, this work is ultimately about masculinity and about an Australian version of masculinity, nonetheless, immersed in Australian culture and our society and its expectations of what a man should be or can be. And so that's why many sequences here such as his immersion in video games or his bullying at school, and his growing up in a household full of military veterans. I mean, not just his grandfather, but his great-grandfather was a World War I veteran. And if we just move along here, this is one of the centerpiece of my entire exhibition. In some respects, you'll see this altar, if you like, which it is. It's actually a very late inclusion into my work. It was only in the last month prior to the exhibition did I think of this concept and realise that it was exactly what I needed to do to round the exhibition. It was like the beginning and the end. Now, in this piece, which is part of the whole, mantelpieces have always, traditionally in housing, have been house altars. That was their original point. Now, over the warmest place in the house, you've got to think of the northern hemisphere here, where this came through, those long, long winter months, and cold autumns and cold springs. It was the warmest place in the house, with a hearth. It was where the cooking was done, it was where the food was done, it was where the heat was. And over it was a mantelpiece. And on that mantelpiece were the few precious objects that in most peasants and poor households had. Might have been their only book, which was usually a Bible, the cross, any other heirlooms and so forth. They were literally sanctified on there. And of course, in more modern times, since the invention of photography, photographs of your family, particularly past members of the family, and your ancestors. And ancestral worship, in some respects, you know, it's a very prevalent part of many cultures in the world, that, you know, the ancestors are always present, they're always with you. And although in a Christian and Muslim and Jewish sense, you know, we don't pay, we certainly don't have the idea of their visible presence, but they are present. You know, we don't forget our past members of our family, mostly we don't. And we sanctify it literally in photographs, and we assemble them on our house altars. And so this is what's here. And I realised this was the most powerful way of showing the household culture, but in some respects, it was symbolically representing how the Anzac myth is a little representation of that, lest we forget. Because that's the whole point of Anzac, was commemorating those who served and those who died in particular, those who were wounded in active service. And in this here, we've got a family version of the same thing. So here we have Michael as his SOS troop after he's enlisted and he's in Afghanistan, but surrounded by the past members of his family. There's Robert Wells as Boona Gona Sandananda walking through the swamp, looking pretty sick. Artie Wells, who in the sacrifice was a hero and tower of strength for Robert, who enlisted straight away. There he is, doing his strength and his enjoyment of being out in the active service in Cyrenaica, or as it used to be called, Libya now. And then Andrea in Vietnam at Vung Tau, the first Australian field hospital, and then the great-grandfathers in their First World War service. So Michael has grown up with this surrounding him, which is in part parcel of his motive, amongst many others. I mean, in this exhibition, when you come in, unlike a book where you start at page one, and you read left to right, top to bottom, and all the way through, and it's presented to you, that's how you start. In a space like this, you can't do that. There is no one starting point. A starting point is wherever the reader, as I like to call it, comes into the room and decides to make a start on the work. People have been asking me at the opening, or closing as it really was, about where do I start, and I said, wherever you want. Let's just begin somewhere. Because before long, if you read the entire work, you'll have gotten the same information no matter what order you picked it up in. So from what I've observed, some people have come in and gone straight to the wall here, straight to this, they've picked up a lot of different things. So for instance, a number of people have come to this work, this part of it, which is in charcoal, not ink. And it's a memory. It's Artie Wells's service in Crete, as assisting the partisans in Crete after the Nazis invaded in 1941. And this is hinted at in the sacrifice that Artie died in Crete. And this explains that story, which is that he was helping the partisans, but the Nazis' technique of trying to root out the British and Australian and other allied soldiers assisting the Cretan partisans was to go to a village where they knew the villagers were hiding them and threatened to and actually execute an entire family if they did not, the village did not reveal where any of these said partisans were. And so naturally, and of course this is the sort of thing that the SS did, and they would actually do that. And in this case, Artie could see a family that he had actually been looking after him and hiding him in their attic was going to be picked to be executed. And the Nazis, being who they were, and the SS in particular, were very efficient about it. I mean, they did actually do it. I mean, there was no, the threats were carried out. And so Artie gives himself up. And if you had read The Sacrifice, you'll have learnt that he died. But no one knows where the body is buried and or anything like that. One of the other things about this work is the presence of original art. Because it's in a gallery space, I mean, early on in the, one of the iterations of the work was I was going to do them all at my normal scale and blow them up digitally. And it became apparent to me at a colloquium, this is where you present a work in progress, that these works being presented in small scale and blown up had no real magic about it. What would we do if you had digital prints? And in galleries, you know, one of the magics of space is encountering the work that's touched by the hand of the artist. I mean, this is an old, you know, it started with the French Falons in the late 18th century, and following on the artist's hero, which was an Italian Renaissance creation, very rapidly spread to Northern Europe and elsewhere in the early 15th century by Giorgio Vasari, who wrote Lives of the Artists, and he was celebrating Michelangelo, Raphael and Leonardo amongst many others. But the artist's hero is a Western invention. And anyway, but the presence of the original is key, so that when tourists go to those big galleries overseas or here, you're going to see literally the relics, the like the old holy relics that used to be venerated in so many churches and still are in Italy. You'll see the relics in reliquaries in built into altars, you know, the finger of a saint or some other part. One thing I was able to do in this work and in by exhibition was do something I can never do in print, and that is leave all the underdrawing in there. So you can see the pencils, the layers, the process of image making is still present. So when you go up closely, you can see it all there. See, in print, all of that gets whited out. It just disappears. And that's fine for print, because you just want to communicate directly with the images. But in the gallery, that's not so necessary. And I mean, theoretically, you could do this in print too, but somehow it would seem wrong because you never normally see it that way. Very, very rare. You can see the trace of a speech bubble that I ended up leaving out, but it's still there in the pencil in the underdrawing. And I love that. I've always loved looking at art and seeing the process there. If I can see the brush marks, if I can see the mistakes, if I can see layers and traces of its making. And so it's something I particularly wanted to keep in this work, because again, in space, in a gallery scenario, I could do that. It seemed appropriate. And so that's another point of substantial difference to this work as to what I might have done in my ordinary practice and work. I mean, the actual method of drawing in ink on paper is my standard practice anyway in any graphic novel that I do. And in that respect, it was quite appropriate to do that and quite interesting to scale it up in this way instead of a small panel of this size. all this large, and as you saw earlier, some substantially larger than they'd in print form. I mean, when I, you know, in print itself, in a book, might only be this big. The original art might be so big, but here, quite large. It's been a very, very interesting and challenging exercise to work to scale of this sort. They were originally put on, I bought several rolls of paper that was 1.5 meters wide by 10 meters long on a roll. And I would cut them into 2.5 meter sheets, and I actually worked on a giant sheet of that size on a big board in my studio at home, assembling them like a comics page, because originally they were going to be presented as big pages. And I chose at a certain point, particularly when I began with the idea of introducing objects, realised that it was no longer sustainable to keep them on those pages. And that's when I decided, I knew then that every panel was going to be split apart. I was going to break the entire work up and present it in the way that you see now. And it's so much better for doing that, because you engage with space. I mean, there's one thing about exhibitions and showing in galleries these days, it's not about pictures on the wall, it's about the entire experience. As soon as somebody enters that door into the space and encountering a work, the space is a part of the work. It's not neutral. I mean, ideally a gallery space should be neutral in the sense it should be white, squarish and not intrude, but it's still a part of the experience of encountering a work. And so we did this. Now, as a kind of a winding up, I'll take you to one piece which just shows you, demonstrates this point. Right, as an example of setting up an exhibition, originally this part was not here. It wasn't ever conceived to be this installation in the way it is here. The box and this black plinth, the black plinth was just brought out of a studio from upstairs, was in another part of the gallery entirely, as part of an exhibition, part of a narrative, next to where the gun was over there. However, when setting up this exhibition, and almost all of it was on the walls all around us, there was this empty corner. It needed something. There was this sense of it sort of tailing off, nothing being here. And my supervisor said, we need to fill this space, and he actually just said, how about we take this plinth and this box over there? And suddenly it looked like a really nice sort of almost exclamation mark. And when we had this spare panel, because there were many spare panels left off here and there, balancing the work out, setting it up, there's one thing I haven't mentioned so far, but about a good quarter to 30% of the drawing and the work that I actually created isn't actually in this gallery right now. Just wasn't any room for it. So hopefully at a later point I can exhibit somewhere else and show the entire work, but right now about 25 to 30% of it isn't actually in here. And this combination of this shock reaction again and this mysterious box with the towel and this sort of unexplained, ambiguous, mysterious quality of this black monolithic thing. It was like an exclamation mark at the end of the exhibition, like a beginning and an end, or it's an end with a dot 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 that sort of suggests more. It's not a conclusion, it's like the cliffhanger image at the end of an episode of television, which wants you to beg for more, and that's in some respects to it. But basically, this was improvised in the studio, in this gallery, on the day we were setting up the exhibition, because when you come into a space, you can't imagine it in advance. You can't imagine, really, you can plan all you like, you can have the schematic of the gallery and the space, but you can't really imagine it until you're actually in here, putting it up on the wall, and then it starts to create that sense of exhibition, the entirety of it, the totality of it. And there are just things you can't expect. And this was like one of them. There's this sense that it needed something to complete the experience, and hence it was improvised on the day. And many of the actual clusters of panels here were not what I had assembled, because I had photographed all the works and created small models of the whole thing, and I realised in certain parts once the balances were worked out, you know, this needs alteration. It doesn't work now that I've seen this next to it on the corner here, and it doesn't work anymore. And I had to make alterations all the time. And that's going to be expected. So even if I install this work in another gallery, which I hope to do, it will probably be different, a little bit different, because that space, however it's shaped, what the light is like, all that will determine the way the exhibition works, because it could be an L-shaped space. It's much larger, but work around an L-shape. In this case, the images from one side of the wall to the other could be quite different. It's only until you get to that space that it can really take shape. So that's another interesting aspect of that I've learnt by installing an exhibition in a gallery space, which, of course, in some respects, we do this in comics, in print too. I mean, the layout of the page, presentation of the book, the type of paper you're putting it on, whether it's landscape, portrait, size, all these things. These are a really, really important consideration in presentation of a work in book form. Publishers and designers know this intimately, and the public know it too, because I think most of us who read, you know, when you get your hands on a lovely hardcover with a lovely silk gloss cover on there, and it becomes a very desirable object. You know, you just want to own this beautiful thing with this beautiful paper and this great story that's inside it. And in some respects, all this is carefully considered in advance of publication as best as can be done. But in a gallery here, you know, you have to wait until you encounter the space and find it there. It has its own dialogue, its own dynamic, and I find that endlessly fascinating. In some of this whole project, it's definitely the start of a new line of practice for me. I definitely want to do more comics in space like this. I can already imagine quite a number of projects that I want to bring into space, taking comics into the space as opposed to on the wall into space, so that you can navigate a forest of panels in a different way. There's a whole number of ideas. I think there's a long way to go. I just hope that this, for me personally, should be the start of a new line of practice. I mean, certainly I will still be making graphic novels. The trilogy will be finished one day, eventually. I know I always get asked this question, but it will be an important part of my practice, the theoretical side, if you like, from here on in. And I'll probably, you know, much of what I've been talking about today, I'll probably put in print at some point. I think I need to get them down. I said earlier that there need to be more work on the formal theory in print, and I'll have to live up to that and do my own version. It's not going to be, I do not want it to be treated like the Ten Commandments. I just want it to be out there to keep that dialogue going, because I think it's a sign of health of a medium that this endless dialogue about it is initiated and continues and breathes life, because it's like scientific research, or it doesn't stop. It cannot stop. It continually refines and refines as new knowledge is made, and sometimes major breakthroughs are made in our understanding of both ourselves, where we are, how we are, and to some degree, of course, the ultimate question of why may come to be answered in these things. And that's humanity. I think that's one of our defining characteristics, is our thirst for understanding. Well, in them, I hope you enjoyed the tour. That's a fairly comprehensive one. I think I've said just about everything. So in that respect, I bid you goodwill. And one day, hopefully, you'll see this exhibition in another place, and another time, and another galaxy.